Welcome all to West Heights United Methodist Church. My tape was on earlier. My name is Bev Baumgartner. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are so glad you are here this morning. I want to point your attention to a playground area over here that people of all ages are welcome to enjoy. And we also have some of our legacy banners here in Gallery West, so stop in to see them. As the light enters the sanctuary, may we center our hearts in an awareness of God's presence in us and among us. Welcome to each one. Will you please join me in the invocation? God, our guiding wisdom, you are all around us. You companion us through ancient texts, modern prophets, the earth, and our own inner depths. We are here to listen, to integrate the teachings of love, to be renewed and transformed by your grace. May it be so. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand as you are able to join in the call to worship. Like trees planted by streams of water, those who delight in God's ways will not wither. Flourishing, they bear fruit appropriate to each season. Through seasons of justice or compassion, seasons of change or of rest, with wisdom and discernment, they blossom and they bloom. Abundant is the harvest of those who trust in God. Blessed is a community that follows the call of love.
Thank you.
welcome the children to join me over here by the tree, if you would. And we're going to sing "Draw the Circle Wide" as we gather. Parker, others, do you ever do yoga at home or at school? Back before we started wearing these masks, we had yoga classes here at church, and sometimes we would stand like this thing here. And I'm not going to do it this morning because I might fall over. That'd be okay if I did. But if you would like to, do you know this pose at all? Yes, where you put your, like that. That's right. This is called the tree pose. That's lovely. You might be able to hold that the whole time we're here together. You're solid on your one foot, and you're using your branch hands to balance. God says that when we're holding on to love and to God, we are like trees that are planted. And what might this be here? Could be a lot of things. Today I'm imagining that it's something that's been coming down from the sky. It's like water. And so you are here standing like a tree planted by the water.
Let's see what happens if you try to blow me.
Okay. Oh, I love that idea. We're going to see what happens if I try to blow this person down. Get ready. Planted. Look at how this kid is saying planted by the water. That's how we want to be, planted, rooted in God's love like trees by the water. And we can all be there together. That's part of how we belong together in God's love. Let's say a prayer before we go back. And you can keep standing in your pose, or you can join me like this. And you can all say it with me if you want. Dear God, thank you for planting us in your love. May we keep standing like trees planted by the water.
Like trees planted by the water.
Amen.
From Psalm 1, from Psalms for Praying by Nan Merrill. Blessed are those who walk hand in hand with goodness, who stand beside virtue, who sit in the seat of truth. For their delight is in the spirit of love, and in love's heart they dwell night and day. They are like trees planted by streams of water that yield fruit in due season, and their leaves flourish. And in all that they do, they give life. The unloving are not so. They are like dandelions which the wind blows away. Turning from the heart of love, they will know suffering and pain. They will be isolated from wisdom, for love knows the way of truth. The way of ignorance will perish as love's penetrating light breaks through hearts filled with illusions. Forgiveness is the way.
Glory, hallelujah, I shall not be moved. Anchored in Jehovah, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved.
In his love abiding, I shall not be moved. And in him confiding, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. Hear these words from John 17, 6 through 19. I have revealed your name to the people you gave me from this world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. This is because I gave them the words that you gave me, and they received them. They truly understood that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I'm praying for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you gave me, because they are yours. Everything that is mine is yours, and everything that is yours is mine. I have glorified in them. I'm no longer in the world, but they are in the world, even as I'm coming to you. Holy Father, watch over them in your name, the name you gave me, that they will be one just as we are one. When I was with them, I watched over them in your name, the name you gave to me, and I kept them safe. None of them were lost, except the one who was destined for destruction, so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Now I'm coming to you, and I say these things while I'm in the world, so that they can share completely in my joy. I gave your word to them, and the world hated them, because they don't belong to this world, just as I don't belong to this world. I'm not asking that you take them out of this world, but that you keep them safe from the evil one. They don't belong to this world, just as I don't belong to this world. Make them holy in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. I made myself holy on their behalf, so that they would also be made holy in the truth. You may be seated.
Will you pray with me? Come, Holy Spirit, and inspire our hearts. If you are with us, then nothing else matters. And if you are not with us, then nothing else matters. May the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts be wholly pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today is the seventh and last Sunday of Eastertide, the season of 50 days, which comes to a climax next Sunday on Pentecost, the festival of the gifting of Holy Spirit and inauguration of the church. This Sunday also marks Ascension Sunday, the final phase of Jesus' great trifecta of death, resurrection, and ascension. The departure that must happen, as he told his disciples, so that the Spirit could arrive. Yet on this last Sunday of Easter, the lectionary beckons us back to the evening of Jesus' last meal with his disciples, the portion that Chris read to us from John's Gospel is near the end of what is known as Jesus' farewell discourse. Four chapters that include some final instructions and promises for his disciples and concludes with his prayer to God. United Methodist pastor and author Dr. James Howell writes that this is not Jesus' last prayer, but it is the one the disciples actually heard when he prayed in agony, "Let this cup pass from me, but not my will, yet your will be done." The disciples had fallen asleep. And when he cried out on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Well, the disciples had forsaken him, fearing for their own safety. Their sorry performance makes Jesus' prayer all that more poignant. The disciples had always wanted in on Jesus' prayer life. They couldn't miss his passionate prayer life with God, that intimacy that he shared. And they had probably said more than once, "Lord, teach us to pray." But in the shadows on that night after supper, Jesus wasn't teaching them to pray because he was praying for them right in front of them. Aware that these are his final hours, Jesus admits to God, "I am no longer in this world, but they are." And this must have dizzied the disciples with confusion, these dark hints and they no doubt would have clung to him if they really understood what he was saying. His words underline a huge problem. Jesus is no longer in the world, but we are. An immense sadness hangs over the surviving disciples, and really over us, who probably feel on our own down here with Jesus not in the world. We wish Jesus' body were still on this earth, but then this very wish gets transformed into our calling, our commissioning, as it were. Jesus' body is no longer here, but Jesus' body is very much here, for we are the body of Christ. Teresa of Avila said, "Christ has no body on earth but yours, no hands but yours, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes which the compassion of Christ looks out on a hurting world. Yours are the feet with which he goes about doing good. Yours are the hands with which he has to bless now." That's a tall order. Jesus should have left his future presence down here in more capable hands than ours. We're just not all that special. We feel no miraculous power coursing through our veins. Our brains get blurry. We're tired. We're stressed. We're just so very ordinary, mortal, human. Had I been in that room with Jesus, I might have interrupted his prayer and pleaded for more truth in advertising, especially when he said to God, "I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world." But we do belong to the world. We don't want out of the world. And we're very much in it, up to our necks, as it turns out. Those of us who gather in person or online to hear sermons, or even those of us who preach them, we are all enthusiastic participants in this world, barely distinguishable from anybody else. Our faith, pasted flimsily on the outside of an otherwise normal existence. We're in the world and of the world, as best I can tell. From my early Baptist days, the words "you are to be in the world, but not of the world" became part of my psyche. And truth be told, I have failed to live out or into that commandment pretty much all of my adult life. I fail at not being materialistic. I fail at harboring only holy thoughts. I don't always witness. Sometimes I struggle to pray for more than 34 seconds. I'm in the world and of the world and find it impossible to take myself out of it. But after studying this passage closer, I noticed Jesus did not issue the commandment, "Be in the world, but not of the world." He wasn't even talking to his disciples. He was talking to God. He was praying. And if I fall on my knees or lift my head and talk to God about this in, not of, business, it becomes a humble confession. and perhaps even my deepest yearning. I can't get it done, but I can lay my failure on the altar of God's heart at the foot of Jesus's cross, and I can express my longing, my truest desire. This is my prayer, to be in but not of this world. Jesus wasn't really praying for just me, though. He was praying for them, for all of us thems. He was praying for the church. We are not very holy, but we can at least pray. St. Augustine said, "Whenever I have described the church as being without spot or wrinkle, I have not intended to imply it was like this already, but that it should prepare itself to be without spot or wrinkle when the church too will appear in glory." So we will be of the world, sadly but hopefully, until we are no longer in the world. What do we do in the meantime? Jesus prayed one more intriguing phrase, that they may be made holy in truth. Other translations read, sanctify or purify them in truth. Truth is elusive in our day. There's just so much BS flying around. How can we be purified in it? Holiness can feel smug and stuffy or like some rigid relic from our religious past. Lots of Christians do believe that faith should make an impression on the real world and change us. But we focus almost exclusively on missions. We'll give a cup of water to the thirsty. We'll serve food at the shelter. We'll send teams out. We'll contribute to homeless children and families. All very good, except atheists do the same thing. Missions are important, of course, but maybe Jesus was praying for the disciples to be holy, not do-gooders, but holy, holy in our souls, in the privacy of our minds, and in our daily habits. How do we, who are in the world, but long to be not so much of the world, how do we actually love the world? We don't wag fingers. We don't pronounce judgment. We don't put others down. We just love. It's been said to love someone is not first of all to do things for them, but to reveal to them their beauty and value. To say to them through our attitude, you are beautiful, you are important. I trust you. You can trust yourselves. We all know well that we can do things for others and in the process crush them, making them feel that they are incapable of doing things by themselves. To love someone is to reveal to them their capacities in life, to help them see the light that is shining within them. Jesus prayed and revealed the beauty in the disciples and in us. Not their ability or strength or perfection, but their beauty. There's one more thing about that beauty. Jesus said, I'm not asking that you take them out of this world, but that you keep them safe from the evil one. Jesus didn't ask God to protect us from evil or to protect us from bad things happening. We're not so good at identifying what's bad and what isn't anyway, are we? But I think it's important to think about this issue of God and whether we're protected from bad things happening or even whether God causes bad things to happen. There are so many half-truths, so many words that are lovingly intended but still are crass lies about God. We need to think about the ways to belong in the world, this world where we have cancer and car crashes and pandemics and tornadoes and terrorists and erratic economy and homeless children. But not to be of the world in the way that we try to make sense of it all. To be clear, God doesn't sow cancer cells in people's bodies. God doesn't crash planes into buildings or cars into other people. God doesn't prescribe one child to live under a bridge while others sleep in soft beds. God is not in control, or perhaps better said, God does not choose to be in control because God is love, and love just can't or won't control. The Apostle Paul says, love does not insist on its own way. God could have made us like puppets, marionettes, hanging from strings, so God could manipulate us and everything to suit God. But God yearns for love. God yearns for our love and cuts the strings, risking the wounds Jesus was about to incur when he prayed for us. Now, understandably, we want everything to go smoothly for us and for others. And we associate God with all that is good. But God is the Lord of everything. In the shadows of that very dark room where Jesus prayed by flickering candlelight for his disciples, we realize that he was about to suffer. And the ones he prayed for would suffer too. As all of us face difficulties, some are manageable, some are overwhelming. But Jesus did not promise or even pray for a bubble of safety to envelop us. Theologian Karl Barth once wrote, "Light exists as well as shadow. Creation has not only a positive, but also a negative side. In creation, there is not only a yes, but also a no. Not only a height, but also an abyss. Not only clarity, but also obscurity. Not only growth, but also decay. Not only opulence, but also indigence. Not only beauty, but also ashes. Not only beginning, but also end." Life is a duality of all things, it seems. Belong in and not of the world. Make them holy in truth. Jesus prayed. The truth of the universe is the body, mind, and heart of Jesus. We are not holy, but we can love. And wherever we find ourselves as individuals and as the church, the body of Christ, We can say, in this place, Christ is loved. And in this place, you are loved. We rather feebly reach out to your wounds and we get it, for we are wounded ourselves. And we touch and we pray. And although our prayers may benefit little, we know that Jesus prayed so that the disciples could see him pray, and he still prays for us now, right now, in heaven. And that is the truth that purifies us. That is our calling in the world we are in and of, but maybe not so much of as we might be. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we belong to you, and for this we are forever grateful. You created us to be in this world, to love with the heart of your Son, Jesus the Christ, and to be his hands and feet. When we forget that, you still love us. And though we fail, you still love us. Life can be hard, and the challenges can be overwhelming. So help us to remember that Jesus is still on the throne, praying for us, and may he be glorified in us. Like trees planted by the waters, help us to remain fully rooted in your love. This morning we remember those who are weak of body, mind, or spirit, those who are recovering and those who struggle in the day-to-day. We pray for your renewing spirit to rest upon us, to heal, strengthen, and empower us. We pray for the Israelis and Palestinians, for peace in their land, and for comfort for all who are grieving this day, for protection upon them all. Hear our prayer, O God. We pray this and sing the prayer your Son taught us.
Remembering that Christ has no body but ours, I invite you, as we remember the offering that we take at the back of the sanctuary and that is received through your trips to the office during the week and online, as we prepare to receive this offering, I invite you to look at your hands, to feel your feet, Mine don't reach the floor when I'm sitting on the pew, but to feel your feet wherever they are and to look at your hands and to join me in a moment of thanks for God's goodness to us, God's presence in our bodies, in our lives, and in our life together. Thanks be to God, God's blessing on these gifts. May God bring us home to the truth of who we are, and may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.